Welcome, everybody. Wonderful to have so many people already logged in and joining us. Looks like we are jumping numbers by the minute, which is fantastic. I just put a note in the chat box. I strongly encourage everybody to have your Q&A box and your chat box open this morning so you can be commenting. We would love to have you share with us your country and your organization so people can learn about who's online, who they might want to connect with in the future, find each other if you're working in the same country or studying in the same country. Thank you for the first person who's done that. That's fantastic. I'm going to get started right away today because we have a really exciting topic, one that clearly is of huge importance. And we have three different people speaking, which is a new format that we're trying out this month. And we want to make sure there's time for everybody and also time for Q&A. So moving right along. Just to remind people, although hopefully everybody already has this down, here is the upcoming webinar schedule. So we're on the second one of the spring, three more coming along. Please note down the date and join us in March, April, and May, and please share with your networks out there. For future webinars, there is a registration sign-up place on the, if you go to the Columbia Gate website and or Columbia Gate Period Posse and enter that in Google, you can sign up and receive the schedule and the links each month. We love your ideas. After the last webinar, we got some great ideas and we're keeping track of them all and hopefully we'll be able to incorporate them in the future schedule. And please also, as you're continuing to do, thank you, Puling, share the invitation of these webinars to your networks. We really want to build out who is communicating, who is finding each other online. It looks like we already have a couple continents linked up communicating today, which is just wonderful. So just as a reminder, we had a fantastic webinar last month with speakers talking about ensuring accessibility and addressing the menstrual needs of people with disabilities. If you missed it, no problem at all. The team uploaded it onto our Columbia Period Posse Presents webinar website. So you can go there, watch the recording of that one or any of the others. And please let other people who you know who work on disabilities, if they want to hear some great speakers, and catch up with what's happening or what the gaps are, it's a great way to learn. As I do with each webinar, I just like to take a moment to speak about the definition and how it needs a little bit of modification, obviously around inclusivity, but this is the definition of MHM back from 2012. Lots of people are working on how we should be modifying this definition and how it can be improved and enhanced and or measured in the years to come. So generally, we've been talking about the menstrual experience, thanks to Julie, who's one of our speakers today, which includes menstrual health and hygiene. And so you will hear probably a mixture of terminology in our webinars, but this is generally what we've been using. So just to sort of speak very generically, because our actual speakers will do a much better job of this, one of the things for the issue of menstruation that many of us have been working on for a number of years, there's been a real intense focus on girls, menstruation and education, obviously in low resource contexts. But menstruation is obviously so very vital across the life course from the time of menarche all the way through menopause. And so one of the ways in which it can be addressed is through puberty education. Another critical one is sexual and reproductive health, both of which overlap with today's topic, which is family planning. And about which the linkages have really not been, up until recently, really well defined in terms of that whole sort of life course experience. There's been an immense amount of work, obviously on family planning and links with menstruation within that, but we all felt, who's speaking today, there could be more articulation of some of the intersections. This was a table. I'm going to go through this super quickly because I want to get to our speakers. When Julie, Amy, and I were working on the paper, which the links we will provide, actually it was just provided by Danielle, thank you, our MPH student working with us. This was one of the tables that did not make it into the paper, but we felt that it would be useful to include it in this webinar, just so you could see some of the ways in which the different sort of phases of that transition from premenarche to adolescent and sexual initiation overlap or intersects with SRH, sexual reproductive health protective behaviors. So because that table was so small, we broke it out into individual slides, which I'm not going to read because I want to get to our speakers. But there's one that sort of focuses on the intersections of premenarche. There is sort of an intersections that speak particularly to menarche, the time when people get their first menstruation and the ways in which it overlaps with knowledge, social support, management of bleeding, contraceptive uptake, and then moving into adolescence, the ways in which there are similar intersections and linkages, and probably also social support and relationships with healthcare providers is one of those, and then onward to sexual initiation and activity. One of the things just in the adolescence one, and probably maybe a little earlier, is sort of the importance of bringing in males to the conversation. So we always like to have a quote in our Period Posse webinars. Today's synergy, the bonus that is achieved when things work together harmoniously. And I think this one was selected today because a lot more probably could be accomplished if we link together sort of the ever-growing menstrual hygiene management, menstrual health, menstrual experience agenda with that of the family planning agenda. We will for sure accomplish more together. So today's webinar, you're already doing it. Fantastic to see who's online. Please scroll through and see who else is joining us if you want to find connections and people to network with in your country and or in your expert community. Please, the speaker contact will be at the end. There's a Q&A box. You may not have seen it. I recommend you open the Q&A box and enter your questions there, and our speakers will be answering the questions there, and then at the very end, we will run through them for as many questions as there's time. So we have two speakers today. Amy Choi, who previously, up until about 2 weeks ago, had been on the faculty of the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Health for many years and sort of a renowned scholar there. Julie Hennegan, also at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, though coming to us from Uganda today. And then a commentary by Chelsea Polis at the Guttmacher Foundation. So really three fantastic speakers. So I'm going to move into our first speaker without further ado. So just give me one moment to both give Amy control of the slides and also unmute her. So Amy, take it away.
Thank you very much. So I appreciate being invited to this Period Posse seminar. And I think, there we are. So I'm going to cover first the definition of family planning, and second its relevance to menstrual health. And you can see the topics here that I hope to get through in 10 minutes. So I pulled the definition of family planning from the Oxford Dictionary, which gives a fairly good generic definition of most things. And it defined it as the practice of controlling the number of children in a family and the intervals between their births, particularly by means of artificial contraception or voluntary sterilization. And there are some embedded elements in this definition that have been contentious, including whether family planning is relevant only for people with families. And secondly, does it always require an interval? Because you can obviously use contraception before and after one birth. And some missed elements here are the infertility. It doesn't address abortion, which we often include under the rubric of family planning. And it also doesn't contextualize family planning with menstrual health and menstrual health cycles. There are many areas, I think, as you saw on the table, where family planning is relevant to menstrual hygiene management. Beginning with several events in the reproductive life course that especially social demographers consider very important. And these are menarche, first sex, first birth, last birth, and the onset of menopause. So there are personal cues for family planning and obstetric needs that are often linked with menstrual bleeding. For example, the return of menses after giving a birth. This cues the woman and her partner that she's exposed to the risk of pregnancy again. Missed menses is a signal of being pregnant. Severe bleeding during pregnancy and after delivery as a obstetric need. And then spotting while using certain contraceptive methods. So those are just examples of how menstruation serves as a cue for both family planning and obstetric need. And the R&D of contraceptive technologies has been closely tied to menstrual patterns. In particular, the oral contraceptive pill, which is very popular in a lot of the global north, was actually developed to emulate the menstrual cycle. So the reason there are 28 pills in a cycle pack is because it was developed to dose according so that women would continue to have monthly menstrual cycles. It could have been dosed differently so that there were longer periods of amenorrhea. Similarly, natural family planning, what we call natural family planning, or fertility awareness methods is developed all around the menstrual cycle. And also the amenorrhea and dysmenorrhea features of hormonal injectables and implants can confer positive or negative experiences to different to women depending on their menstrual hygiene needs and experience needs. And then, of course, the research and development around abortion technologies is also tied with menstruation. The whole, in Bangladesh, the concept or construct of menstrual regulation is more widely known than, say, elective pregnancy termination. And often we hear women talking about a desire to bring back or bring on their menses. So I put this table together just so those of you who may not be familiar with a lot of these life course markers can see ages at which women experience these events or their level or the prevalence level of the events in different sub-Saharan African countries. And first of all, you can see that the average age of at menarche and the average age at menopause in this study by French bioscientists is about 35 years apart. So 13.5 to 48.5. So 35 years of menstrual cycling. And median age at first sex runs around 16 to 8 to 17 in these countries. And the median age at first marriage or union around 18 to 19. And then the percent who have given a birth before age 18 is about a third. And then after each birth, there's approximately 10 to 15 months of postpartum amenorrhea, particularly where there is prolonged breastfeeding. And then in the West, this is not the case. And then by 30 to towards the end of the childbearing period, roughly 10 to 12, 15% of women are already reporting symptoms that classify them as being menopausal. So these are from the DHS. But what you can tell is that given menarche happening around 13 and the median age of first sex around 16 is about 3 years before first sex, and the first union is almost a year just after first sex, and having a birth happens fairly soon after that for a fair number of women. So there, given the 35 years between first and last menstrual bleed, that can be as many as 455 menstrual cycles in the life course. And these cycles are reduced by months of pregnancy, postpartum amenorrhea, and when menopausal onset happens. And one thing we know is that as the average number of births declines, which is happening pretty much all over the world, the number of cycling months increases. And so this points to more bleed cycles, which means also between menstruation, there's higher monthly risk of conception if coital frequency stays constant, which all points to greater MHM and family planning needs. It's pretty clear from this slide that the correct knowledge of the fertile period is fairly poor, in low middle income countries. This is from the Demographic and Health Surveys, looking at 73 countries organized by region. And there should be, this is a, these are box plots showing the proportion of women for each type of response. And the they're bookended by the highest and lowest percentage, and then they show the interquartile range within the shaded box. But there should be more, there should be more orange, but instead you see a number of other times that are identified as when it is not safe for the woman, when the woman is most likely to become pregnant. So even just basic information about the menstrual cycle, when it's a safe period, would be an important first start. This next table comes from a study, a WHO study, and it shows that side effects or health concerns, which is where bleeding changes are reported most often, are a major reason for why women stop using. This is showing the by method for the pill, and I boxed out the pill, IUD, injectable, and injectable. This box should have moved down to periodic abstinence, but it just shows that majority of users will stop using their contraception at the first, at the end of the first, second, or third year due to reported concern about side effects or health consequences. And you'll hear more about this from Chelsea Paulus. So I took from her paper. This is in an additional file, which you have to retrieve. But it showed the number of studies finding women participants citing discontinuation due to contraceptive-induced menstrual bleeding changes. And the number of studies that their scoping review covered showed that there were 19 studies that cited bleeding changes as a reason for having the implant removed, 8 studies showing that bleeding changes were a reason for discontinuing the IUD. So bottom line is that there are, that bleeding changes do affect how long women will use a method. And I saw that the article about the vaginal ring being used by HIV positive females was put onto the Q&A box, I think it is, or the chat box. And that was an interesting article because it looked at 3 countries and talked to HIV positive females who had removed the vaginal ring, which does not need to be removed during menstruation. But they removed it because they were worried about what was in their mind called vaginal overload. So that I think is important to think about menstruation and birth control together. Lastly, just to reiterate this underappreciated relevance of menstruation to reproductive and sexual health. Menstruation is obviously a recurring event over the life course. The more menstrual cycles that happen, the more risk of conception of an unintended pregnancy, and therefore the more important that adequate information about family planning means is available. We could take sexual activity actually is planned around and during menstruation as well. Condom use during menstruation is cited in a number of studies, and obviously, people who are using fertility awareness methods will schedule coital activity around their menstrual periods. So there are neglected gateway moments that we can take advantage of, both menarche and also the framework of menstrual regulation, the language there, which could be more socially acceptable. And last, that most women using birth control expect menstrual regularity. And there was a study that we collected in the performance monitoring accountability data, which showed this last year, 80% of women aged 15 to 49 felt that it was not healthy to have irregular menstrual periods. So with that, these areas for strengthening bonds are where my colleagues are going to talk, and I'm going to just turn it over to them to continue the conversation.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Amy, for that terrific introduction. Oopsie, I didn't mean to. All right, I'm just going to take back control. So I think that really set the course for where we're going to go next, sort of framed the family planning. And we're hoping very much that people online are coming both from the family planning community and the menstrual sort of health and hygiene community. And so that just hearing both of these sort of framing presentations and specifics about intersections will help to shift this agenda forward. So please continue to enter your country and your institution. I think it's wonderful for people to find each other on these webinars and who's in the chat box. And then also please continue to enter your questions in the Q&A box. And so I'm just going to, I'm going to play Julie's presentation now because she has medium connectivity in Uganda. We pre-recorded, but she will be online for the live Q&A at the end. Oopsie, just
okay, so thanks to Marnie for having me, and thanks to Amy for providing such a great overview of the links between menstruation and family planning. To continue our conversation on these linkages and this topic, I'm going to think and focus a little bit on the links still between menstruation and family planning, but also connected to this rapidly growing field of research practice and policy of menstrual health and hygiene. So what are we thinking about when we think about menstrual health and hygiene? We're often thinking about menstrual education and knowledge of the menstrual cycle. We're thinking about whether women and girls and people who menstruate have access to clean, reliable menstrual materials and their preferred materials. We're thinking about if they have supportive places or spaces for changing, for washing and drying those materials. And that includes female-friendly toilets, sanitation infrastructure, and access to water. We're often thinking about menstrual stigma and social restrictions and expectations that exist around menstruation and might and do impact individuals' experience of having their period. And increasingly, perhaps we're thinking about the diagnosis and care of menstrual disorders, pain, and other symptoms that individuals might experience. And those of us working in menstrual health and hygiene know that there's many of these needs, or these menstrual health and hygiene needs, remain unmet across the globe. And I've got some examples from different studies on the slides. When we think about these challenges for menstrual health and hygiene, we often think about their impact on individuals' menstrual experiences. So we think about how having these unmet knowledge or material needs might be distressing or associated with shame, with a lack of confidence to go about your usual day during menstruation, or with physical discomfort and irritation. When we then think about broader impacts on what unmet menstrual health and hygiene needs mean for individuals, we often think about adolescent school attendance, for adult women at work. We might think about relationships with reproductive tract infections if we have individuals struggling to maintain adequate quantities of menstrual materials and change them often. But focusing on these outcomes, as much as they make sense for those working on menstrual health and hygiene issues, this focus often overlooks many of the interrelationships that exist between menstruation and reproduction and family planning that Amy was talking about earlier. So in my brief time today, I wanted to highlight some of these pathways and follow up on these linkages and outline what we've identified as sort of four opportunities for better linking menstrual health and hygiene with family planning. And ways in which I think both fields or both people working on these issues can mutually achieve their goals for the people that they're serving. These come from a discussion paper that Amy, Marnie, and I published a few months ago, and the citation's on the slide if you're interested in looking at that a little bit more. So the first of these is the window of opportunity that's presented by Menarche. Menarche marks both the start of menstrual periods and then menstrual health and hygiene needs, but also the onset of fertility and potential unmet need for family planning. Often family planning and sexuality education programs might start well after this milestone. And we argue that engaging early in adolescence at or before menarche provides opportunities both for menstrual health and hygiene advocates and also to improve family planning. Early education and engagement provides an opportunity for individuals to receive menstrual cycle information. This may prepare adolescents for their first menstruation or their early menstrual years. It can help dispel myths about what menstruation is and the restrictions that go along with it. And it can support effective menstrual management. When we're then thinking about the objectives of family planning programs, this information can provide foundational awareness of reproductive anatomy, the menstrual cycle, and perhaps the links between menstruation and fertility, something that knowledge about is lacking in many populations. Even in the absence of other contraceptive information, if communities feel that it's too early to provide this before or at menarche, menstrual cycle information still provides a foundation onto which later understanding of how contraceptives work, their side effects, why they're needed, can be built onto. Beyond just early education, early engagement between females and reproductive healthcare providers provides opportunities for the menstrual health and hygiene space to address menstrual disorders, to address pain. For those in family planning, it offers the opportunity for females to build positive relationships and expectations of reproductive health care providers. These relationships and expectations that if you seek out these providers, they will provide sort of compassionate, destigmatizing information is needed for motivating and I guess setting expectations for engagement when it comes time to seek family planning services or seek support for your family planning methods. Menstrual health and hygiene and family planning both rely on an understanding of the menstrual cycle. And this isn't just needed at menarche or in the early menstrual years, but it continues over the life course. When both menstrual health and hygiene practitioners or family planning practitioners are providing menstrual cycle information, we think there are opportunities for mutually improving women's experience of both their menstruation and their family planning use. From a family planning perspective, programs placing greater emphasis on understanding the menstrual cycle and reproductive anatomy might address menstrual health and hygiene needs by addressing ongoing information or knowledge gaps or taboos. Likewise, menstrual health and hygiene information programming or programs might help support foundational menstrual knowledge so that family planning interventions aren't playing catch up or trying to shift already ingrained misconceptions and knowledge gaps about menstruation when they come to provide information about different contraceptives or family planning methods. Both fields have opportunities to benefit each other in engaging men and boys around menstruation. That might improve the support that they provide to women and girls during menstruation and also men's understanding and use of family planning methods. Having improved knowledge about the menstrual cycle, again, to continue talking about knowledge, is likely to influence an individual's experience and response to contraceptive-induced menstrual bleeding changes. But beyond knowledge, improved menstrual health and hygiene is also likely to influence an individual's experience of contraceptive-induced bleeding changes. So the stigma and silence around menstruation might prevent women having open discussions with each other about bleeding changes that they're experiencing in response to their contraceptives. It might prevent them from seeking care or discussing bleeding changes with their healthcare provider. It's also likely that the restrictions that apply to menstruating women are going to be applied during breakthrough bleeding that occurs during contraceptive use. And these are also likely to continue whether or not bleeding is lighter, is heavier, is irregular. So if women are experiencing sort of taboos or restrictions on their activity whenever they're bleeding, this might cause more frustration and distress with menstrual bleeding changes. Similarly, if an individual is struggling to manage their regular menstrual period, this is going to influence how she views and her response to both the potential of contraceptive-induced changes as well as changes when they actually occur. So management of heavier bleeding might be costly and more difficult for women. If menses become more irregular, that also might cause frustration. If there's if they're less predictable, or an individual still struggles to manage spotting or other lighter breakthrough bleeding. At the same time, those from menstrual health and hygiene can consider that contraceptives may offer benefits to individuals in reducing the burden of menstrual management needs, as well as anemia, and address some menstrual disorders and symptoms. And lastly, of our, I guess, our four opportunities that we've identified, both menstrual health and hygiene and family planning programs seek to empower women. Sexuality education increasingly includes programs and interventions that are aiming to empower females to avoid coerced sex, to take control of their decisions regarding their reproductive health care, their fertility, and improve their sense of agency over their bodies. At the same time as we're trying to increase this control and agency, research across menstrual health and hygiene topics has suggested that, you know, women's experience of menstruation can be really disempowering, and that menstruation has been associated with a sense of low agency, low levels of feeling of control over the body. So improving an individual's menstrual experience, improving their confidence and agency, their informed decision making around their menstrual period, might represent an opportunity to build a sense of bodily autonomy and control that could help support empowerment and agency during family planning interventions and during family planning practices. This is something that we hypothesize. I think more research is needed with regards to this topic. But menstruation does or could present an opportunity to build this autonomy that could follow through to one's experience of family planning and negotiation of family planning use. So drawing it together very, very quickly, I've outlined a few key takeaways for policymakers and for practitioners. I think hopefully what's come across is that menstrual education is needed. From a menstrual health and hygiene perspective, it's needed before menarche. So providing education at these earlier ages might help advance both the menstrual health and hygiene and family planning agendas. For policymakers, this might mean needing improved data on the age of menarche in that country to help identify the proper age or an appropriate age for such education. Many synergies exist in providing menstrual education, both for improving menstrual health and family planning. So supporting these initiatives and coordinating between these different sectors might be particularly important for policymakers. I'd also suggest that investment in menstrual health may also support advances in family planning, improve menstrual cycle information, experience of menstrual hygiene and managing your period, and reducing menstrual stigma and restrictions might all support women to manage their family planning and any associated bleeding changes that they experience. For practitioners, I think our key takeaways are around identifying opportunities for collaboration between those implementing menstrual health programs and those working on family planning. There are opportunities to share learning. What are effective education strategies? How can we reduce stigma around these different topics? To educate healthcare providers about menstruation, to understand the taboos or the existing situation of menstrual health and hygiene might be particularly useful for informing family planning counseling and gaining that knowledge from those who are working in menstrual health. My message to both sectors or fields would be for menstrual health practitioners to, con- to consider where their programs may have pathways to improving family planning objectives, both in their program design and evaluation, and for family planners to consider the contribution of menstrual health challenges to their program objectives and their outcomes. So thank you, and feel free to ask questions and to follow up if that's useful.
Wonderful. So fantastic. I think we've had two amazing presentations, one that really frames for those of us, particularly in the menstrual community, I think we're less familiar with the family planning definitions and language and issues. So really great to have Amy's framing and then to have Julie dig into some of the specifics of what we thought might be good areas of intersection for these two critically important and aligned areas or fields. And just a note on Julie's comment about how it would be great if more countries had age of menarche to help focus their interventions. But finally, the DHS has added a question on menarche just late last year. So hopefully we'll start to see some of that data come in as countries go forward with new DHS survey. So we're going to keep moving. We've got about 91 people online now. Please continue to let us know what country you're in and what your institution is. And I encourage you to scroll through, see who else is online, find each other if you're in the same country or working in similar organizations. And we have about 9 questions. 2 are already answered in the Q&A box, and we will come back to those after Chelsea, our wonderful commentary maker, who I'm now unmuting, gives us some thoughts. So welcome, Chelsea.
Great. Thank you so much. And good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you are in the world. Really excited to join. Grateful to Dr. Summer and the webinar organizers for inviting me. And a huge thanks to Dr. Choi and Dr. Hennegan for their really excellent presentations. So as Dr. Summer said, I'm just going to give a few very brief comments, about 5 minutes, to share a little bit of information as well about an upcoming meeting that is extremely relevant to the topic of today's discussion. I wanted to start by just saying how much I appreciated that Dr. Choi titled her presentation Menstrual Health Matters for Family Planning, and Dr. Hennegan really reinforced this in several ways. That connection might seem obvious to people who are motivated to join today's webinar, but it does really seem like our field's kind of collective appreciation for just how very much menstrual health does matter for family planning has recently started to deepen, and it's really exciting to start seeing those linkages being so clearly articulated. So for example, we've known for quite some time from analysis of DHS and other data that health concerns and side effects are top reasons for contraceptive non-use or discontinuation among people who want to avoid pregnancy. But we've had fewer studies that have investigated which specific health concerns and side effects are of greatest concern. And so that was part of our motivation for doing the scoping review that Dr. Choi mentioned on contraceptive-induced menstrual bleeding changes, or what we called CIMBCs. And so we tried to look at a wide array of different study designs to try to better understand what the literature says about women's responses to CIMBCs. And we found that many studies report CIMBCs as top reasons for contraceptive discontinuation, dissatisfaction, or non-use. We also found that preferences around bleeding patterns is extremely variable. So for example, contraceptive methods that induce amenorrhea may be completely unacceptable to one person and absolutely beloved by somebody else. And what this does is really reinforce and underscore the importance of contraceptive choice. And in terms of what we know, it's worth flagging that a lot of the information that we have on preferences in relationship to contraceptive bleeding patterns that have come from large surveys are generally coming from countries in the global north. And so there's an evidence gap here to ensure that we're surveying women around contraceptive bleeding preferences all around the world. And then beyond simply being aware that menstrual changes can play a key role in contraceptive acceptability, it's really important to go deeper and really investigate how people interpret and understand CIMBCs, how menstruation and menstrual changes might make people think about or sometimes worry about their body, and how social and cultural interpretations of menstruation impact all of this. So this plays out in terms of how menstruation or the lack thereof can be linked in some people's minds with concerns about a wide range of health conditions. For example, we know that there's a great deal of stigma that surrounds menstruation and menstrual blood. Some people see menstrual blood as dirty and believe that because it's dirty, it needs to come out of the body every month so that the body can be cleansed. So this might lead to misinterpretations of contraceptive-induced amenorrhea as dirty blood building up in their body. And then some people believe that this built-up dirty blood can lead to things like cancer. Or some people interpret amenorrhea as being a blockage of blood that builds up in the body and risks suddenly rushing out all at once, leading to immediate death. Other contraceptive methods like IUDs can cause an increase in the amount of menstrual blood lost, and some people describe a belief that this extra blood loss might cause them to become infertile. So these beliefs or these pathways are not supported by biomedical evidence, but they really drive home the importance that our field understands the meanings that people ascribe to bodily functions like menstruation, and that without understanding these kind of things, we can't really fully understand the dimensions of contraceptive acceptability or provide appropriate counseling. And then, of course, it's important to note that some CIMBCs are perceived as beneficial. So for example, hormonal IUD users in some studies in Spain and Austria, I believe, appreciated that there were reductions in heavy menstrual bleeding and reductions in painful periods when they use those methods. In addition to health, CIMPCs can also have truly profound impacts on some people's domestic, work, school, sports, and religious lives. So for example, there was a study that noted that in Bangladesh, women are prohibited from praying, having sex, performing certain household tasks, or participating in community activities during menstruation. And these are also activities that women are often expected to regularly do. And so this can create a tension, and certain contraceptive methods can then really exacerbate that tension. So for example, IUDs, a highly effective contraceptive method, can sometimes increase the duration of menstruation. So multiple women in this study that I mentioned in Bangladesh wound up discontinuing the IUD, and that's not necessarily because they didn't like the method itself, but because of how the method increased menstruation, which therefore exacerbated various prohibitions on their time and activities due to cultural norms, which therefore impacted their social and marital lives. And in some cases, this even led to domestic violence, intimate partner violence. So if we kind of blithely say, oh, you know, most side effects from contraception are manageable, we might be missing a key factor and underappreciating the wider cultural context in which these kind of side effects are lived and interpreted, both positive and negative. And so we really need to ensure that healthcare providers are taking people's concerns about CIMBCs very seriously and addressing them in a non-judgmental manner, because these changes might not be seen by the user as only a minor concern. And as was mentioned earlier, all of this is incredibly important with respect to refining existing contraceptive methods and developing new contraceptive methods or even new multi-purpose prevention technologies, which are products in development that could simultaneously prevent pregnancy and HIV or other STIs. If we don't fully understand preferences around contraceptive-induced menstrual bleeding changes, then the actual potential impact of really exciting new developments in contraceptive technologies and MPTs could be inhibited. So I think I've probably already gone over my time, so I'm just going to wrap up very quickly by mentioning an upcoming meeting that I'm incredibly excited about, and I think most of you will be too. FHI 360 is planning a technical consultation on contraceptive-induced menstrual changes, going beyond just menstrual bleeding, but into other related changes. The meeting's with funding from USAID, and it's in collaboration with a wider steering committee on which I am also serving. This group is going to focus on contraceptive-induced menstrual changes with the planned objectives of the meeting being convening experts in contraception and menstrual health fields to review the knowledge base and research around contraceptive menstrual changes with a focus on user perspectives and experiences, to identify evidence gaps and determine approaches to address them, to facilitate increased connection and collaboration between the contraception and menstrual health fields, and to set research priorities and an agenda forward on contraceptive menstrual changes. So I believe that the date for this meeting is going to be sometime in the summer, I believe in Washington, D.C. There will be an option for remote participation. The first day of the meeting will focus on research and knowledge sharing, and excitingly, it's open to anybody who's interested in joining. The second day will be by invitation, and it'll involve a smaller working group that will work on refining the research agenda. So Amelia McKenzie, who I believe is a participant on the webinar today, can share more information with folks who are interested. And I think more information about the meeting will be shared more widely very soon. So please do stay tuned. I will wrap up there, and thanks again for inviting me.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And also thank you, Amelia, for including your email if anybody's interested. I'm sure there will be a number of people interested who to participate either in person or remotely. And there's an absolutely fantastic chat box conversation happening, both in terms of people saying where they are, what they're working on. We have a real diversity of participants today, from those working in contraceptive technologies to menstruation to filmmaking, so to studying the issue. So please continue to engage. And thank you, Chelsea. That was a really wonderful presentation, connecting and also sort of bringing together the two prior ones. So we have a thank you. I think Julie has already, and Amy have already jumped in and answered some of the questions, which is really, and Chelsea, which is wonderful. So I'm not gonna go through those, and we can circulate them after the webinar when we send out the recording. I'm going to unmute everybody, and then just sort of, we have some time to go through some of the questions. So I'm just gonna pick and choose and sort of go round robin with people, just so that we get at some of them. So, and then whoever feels they want to answer is, it's just fine. So actually some of these are comments. How to create a social need. So this one, I think I could probably even answer. How to create a social need, but I'm curious to hear, for MHM products among different levels of stakeholders, like girls, women, government, and policy regulations, private sector companies who charge their products at such a higher price. So I might just say there are a lot of social entrepreneurs and new companies starting to develop products, and also there are a lot of projects trying to teach people how to make local sanitary pads. And so I think there's a range of activities happening to generate interest in different kinds of menstrual products, and actually we probably should do a webinar just on that, and we've had some interest expressed, so we may log that as a future topic to include. People have been answering what CIMBC stands for, contraceptive induced menstrual bleeding changes, so thank you for that. And Amelia, thank you for the more extensive response around that. We have a question where religious and programming is amongst the socially or religiously conservative, where research and programming is amongst the socially or religiously conservative. Is there not a case for keeping the two things separate? I'm playing devil's advocate. Here in the UK, in some areas, it's difficult to teach menstrual health to girls if parents think it's about sex. So I'm gonna comment on that, and then I don't know if others want to, but I actually very much agree with you that there is a huge benefit to keeping these separate. We found in countries where we develop puberty books for girls and boys that include content on menstruation and menstrual health and hygiene, that governments, ministries of education have been approving, and some interest from churches and other religious groups, then framing it as puberty and early body change and not linking it to SRH and family planning explicitly is actually, I think, a way to start that conversation and engage more people on this issue and educate more young people. That being said, it may be that it's a good stepping stone. So I don't know if any of the others, Julie, Amy, maybe want to comment on that, because I do agree with you, but I think there are ways in which maybe it's the next step in terms of education, maybe it's the healthcare providers. But Amy or Julie, what would you say to that question?
I defer to Julie on this one.
Okay. Julie, are you with us?
I agree. I think there's arguments to be made for
for linkage and for keeping things more separated. I think when we talk about making linkages, we mean the sectors as a whole. I don't think we mean that if we're providing, you know, early information on menstrual health, that it has to include information on family planning. And I think there are certainly cases, and Moni's already mentioned, where it's more effective to talk exclusively about puberty and menstrual health. But what I think part of what we'd like to argue in both our paper and in the webinar is that providing that early menstrual health education should be seen as an opportunity by the family planning field, that sort of another sector is laying the foundational knowledge that they can pick up on later. So I don't think that educators necessarily need to provide a whole lot of family planning or any sex education. But if you have a basic understanding of your menstrual biology, your reproductive organs, what menstrual blood is, that your menstrual cycle, you know, is a cycle, and that there are hormones involved in this sort of basic understanding, then when later someone comes to explain to you fertility, when someone comes to explain to you how contraception works and what contraceptive induced menstrual bleeding changes are, then you have a better foundation to incorporate that knowledge and to understand it. So I think it's not necessarily about delivering that information together, but as seeing the fields as more synergistic, if that's a word, or being able to synergize across, even if that information is delivered separately.
Yeah, fantastic, and said much better than my attempt to answer it. 100% agree. And I think one of the things for those of us working menstruation have found lacking is we've certainly found a huge gap in young people's knowledge about their periods, both before they get their periods and even after. And frankly, my team has been doing research in the U.S. the last 18 months, and the lack of knowledge is not so dissimilar here than what we find in other countries. Seeing it, finding the ways we can come together and seeing it as a platform for later sort of family planning SRH, I think is the perfect way to think about it, because really that linking, I think, is not happening very often right now. We have a question. I'm not sure who could best answer this. Can I ask if the normal job aid has been evaluated, and if so, towards what outcome? Does it reduce discontinuation due to CIMBC? Someone want to jump in? It could be Amy, Chelsea, or Julie. And if you don't know, that's fine too.
I guess Chelsea would know.
This is Chelsea. I don't believe that it's been evaluated with respect to whether it reduces discontinuation of CIMBC. I don't know if Amelia is able to speak live on the webinar, but she's here and she may be able to share more on that.
Okay, if anybody has other thoughts, just to enter those in the chat box. Go ahead.
Oh, Amelia just chimed in to say that they are analyzing data from an evaluation in Malawi as we speak about normal.
I wonder if the panelists could talk about how those working in menstrual health are thinking about addressing the menstrual needs of contraceptive users, especially with those experiencing contraceptive induced menstrual changes. I'm not sure that they are, but Julie, what would you say to that question?
I think we're talking about these linkages more and more. So I'm optimistic that we are starting to think about this and addressing these menstrual needs more and more. I guess I'd break this down into where are we addressing, you know, population needs in general. If we're addressing the menstrual health needs of whole groups of people, then those using contraceptives should also be having, you know, safer spaces and more supportive spaces for managing their period, or better access to preferred materials. In terms of explicitly making those linkages, I'd love to see more and more of that and more engagement from menstrual health folks on this topic. I think we have been very focused on adolescent girls, where this is less, comes up less, but I think, towards the future, that we need to be engaging in this more.
Great. And just to note, for those of you who are still with us, there have been quite a number of great resources. Sylvia, thank you for the one you just posted, that are being shared in the chat box, from videos to articles to reports and documents. And that's another way we'd really like to see these Period Posse webinars used, as a way to share resources between you. I think that's most of the questions. So I'm just going to finish up with a few final slides. And just to say again, an enormous thank you to our speakers today for really, I think, filling a huge gap in the conversation around this, and to start maybe some new conversations between you and others who maybe watch the recording once it's posted on our website and get shared, around what we should be doing that we're not yet doing, and how we can bring these fields, which are really so related, together. So future webinars, please remember to sign up so you're registered for the whole series. The registration link is in the chat box somewhere, and maybe we can post it again just before we sign off. Please, again, as I said at the beginning, send us any ideas you have for future webinars. And then please share the Period Posse registration link once you get the link from us, or it's up there now. Thank you, Danielle, who just posted it. For anybody who you think should be, is interested in this issue, whether it's your students, your teams, your colleagues in your country, your government, sort of point people on this issue, it'd be wonderful to sort of, from the time our three speakers put into today, it would be wonderful to have the learning shared even wider. So just for next month, we will have a webinar with more wonderful speakers. Bethany from Emory University, Bethany Caruso, Therese Mahan from WaterAid, with commentary provided by Caroline Kabiru at the POP Council, Population Council in Kenya. And just a little brief note on this webinar, there was a meeting last year in Geneva where we brought together people working on menstruation in girls, whether it was from intentionally from sort of those working on monitoring from the water sanitation community, the SRH community, the gender community, the education community, and the psychosocial community. And everyone got sort of locked in a room for 3 days to hammer out where we are on monitoring and measuring outcomes in relation to MHH in girls. And so although a 3-day meeting cannot be condensed into an hour-long webinar any more than family planning and periods can be included in one short webinar, we think it will be a good platform, and we'll provide the report that came out of that meeting if people want to go deeper. So very much hope that you can join us next month. Tremendous thanks again for everything. Siri, thank you for what you're posting, and to everybody else. And we're going to sign off in just a few minutes or seconds. But huge thanks again to all of our speakers, and hope everybody has a wonderful rest of their day, afternoon, evening, or whatever time zone you are in. Great. Take care.